It's been quite a while since OBS Studio has released a major update, but this is for a good reason. The OBS devs have been hard at work making some pretty beefy changes to OBS's GPU encoding and some other cool stuff, allowing for better performance and a lot of major upgrades in the coming updates. I'm going to walk you through the upcoming OBS Studio version 23 update today after a word from our sponsor. Alright, so there's two major changes or improvements in OBS Studio 23, stream integration or stream service integration for sign-in and chat boxes, and a complete rework of how the NVENC or NVENC NVIDIA GPU encoder works, which lays the groundwork for future changes I'll mention as well. There's a couple cool extra things and a lot of little bits that I'll cover as well after these. So firstly, OBS now supports direct integration of streaming services, so you can sign in with your Twitch or Mixer account directly instead of fiddling with stream keys, and you get a dockable chat box from your streaming service within OBS. This does this without the bloaty overhead of Streamlabs OBS's UI. This also gives you access to a dockable panel for Twitch stats, such as current viewers and subs, and your stream information panel to change your stream titles and game names. By the way, if it doesn't load for dark mode for you automatically and you have it enabled on Twitch in your browser, just relaunch OBS, it should reload it. This only works with Twitch and Mixer for now, but expanded support is planned at some point. This is just the beginning. Also, the stats window is now dockable, so you can easily keep an eye on dropped or skipped frames and all of that jazz, which is something I've been requesting for a while. The next major change in this update is what's been commonly referred to as the new NVENC. And again, I want to do a little bit of myth busting here. The actual quality improvements of NVENC on NVIDIA's new RTX 20 series Turing graphics cards is primarily a hardware change. There is a physical NVENC chip on the card that has been altered and improved to increase quality. This applies to any use of the NVENC encoder with these cards in any program. Old OBS, updated OBS, video editing software, anything. The new NVENC settings in this OBS update can help you squeeze a little bit more quality out of your stream by means of giving you more control, but it's not a direct quality improvement. That's not what the point of it is. It is actually a hardware improvement on those 20 series cards. I'm recording a video and I got a kitty climbing all over me. Say hello. Not to me, to them. Hello, I am Stream Kitty. Also, this new encoding pipeline does not work on Windows 7. OBS will fall back to the old methods that I explain in a moment on Windows 7. This should, however, work on Windows 8.1 and obviously Windows 10. This new NVENC is a complete rework of how OBS interacts with the GPU for GPU-based encoding. In previous versions of OBS, it was designed to handle only raw video frames in system memory, or RAM. The frames had to be copied from the GPU's VRAM to RAM and then sent off to the encoder, which at the time was predominantly x264 that ran on your CPU. So that design made sense at the time, and sending it from GPU to RAM to CPU for encoding. However, because of this design, that meant that when using GPU encoding, like NVENC, it would have to copy frames from VRAM to RAM and then be sent off to NVENC, which then would be copied back from RAM to VRAM again, resulting in an unnecessary round trip due to that video pipeline design. This uses up more resources and bandwidth than is necessary, and adds a little bit of latency. In the latest version of OBS, there's now an additional discrete video pipeline for GPU encoders that can take a texture directly without moving any raw frames out of VRAM. This eliminates the unnecessary VRAM to RAM to VRAM round trip, thus maximizing the potential performance of hardware encoders such as NVENC and reducing the impact that it might have on the games that you're running while streaming or recording. On higher end systems where things were already running smoothly, you may not notice any difference, but in some side-by-side comparisons, you could see as much as 5 to 10 frames per second or even more in some weird scenarios maybe, increase in game, and that scales as hardware gets worse. Along with this update came more direct access to the NVENC tools and some new quality controls. They're named a little silly, but they let you do some cool stuff if you're in the OBS's advanced output mode. Two-pass encoding is now no longer a direct option, but it is automatically part of the max quality preset. This determines how much load is put on the NVENC encoder to get the most quality. Most people can just use max quality and be fine, but if you're getting encoder overloaded errors, lower it to quality to see if that improves. Generally speaking, profile should always be set to high for these kinds of streaming purposes. It tunes the encoder in a way that just needs to be set to that. Look ahead and psycho visual tuning are new options. Look ahead allows the encoder to dynamically change the amount of B frames between 0 and the max number that you input at the bottom of the UI where it says max B frames. These are frames used to get the most quality out of your footage. They're kind of like reference frames at full quality, but they require a lot of bandwidth. So on high motion content, you don't always want a ton of those, as they can reduce quality without enough bitrate assigned to your stream. Look ahead helps save you some trouble by automatically determining how much to use based on the frames, or based on your content. Psycho visual tuning improves image quality on moving footage by enabling the rate distortion optimization, which is just a setting within the encoder itself that affects high motion footage. For high motion content, shooters, action games, things like that, set max B frames to 2. For low motion content, such as card games or desktop capture, things like that, you can increase this to 4. However, if you do see pixelization on stream, consider reducing this back to 2. Keyframe interval needs to be set for 2 as for streaming on Twitch and YouTube as always, and set your max bitrate according to your streaming service and upload speed as usual. I have a whole video on this in the description if you're interested. Also, you do still technically have the option of offloading encoding onto a second GPU here, but that will cause OBS to fall back to the old NVENC implementation since you can't share this information between GPUs directly. Either way, keep in mind that this is generally a bad idea despite how many people have been suggesting it with my recent videos and does not address that GPU utilization issue that I talked about in my recent kind of ranty, it was more like a FAQ video than anything. You see, OBS itself still needs to render and composite on the GPU that your game or display is running on, and that's where the bulk of OBS's GPU usage and impact comes from. Encoding is very efficient and it's on its own chip on the GPU, so offloading that not only does not help your performance, but it more or less negates any of this updated framework's benefits if you were able to do it within the new NVENC anyway. It's also worth noting that within the new NVENC, I am saying that wrong now, you will be unable to apply rescaling during output. If you want a different output resolution than your canvas, you'll have to apply it universally in the video settings tab. Sucks, but it's worth the trade-off. If you do enable rescale output in the encoder settings for NVENC, OBS will fall back to using the old NVENC implementation again. The cool thing here is that theoretically, this rework can be applied to all GPUs in the future. Currently, the only iteration is for NVIDIA cards, and I can't even begin to speculate when AMD or Intel support will be added, but the work done here can benefit everyone in the end. A new version of the AMD AMF or VCE GPU encoder has been integrated, which does fix some issues with AMD Vega GPUs. I can't really test this or anything right now, but that's a thing. A big one from my OBS request video from last year, OBS can now batch remux lots of MKVs or FLVs to MP4, and you can even set it to auto remux after you hit stop recording. The remux recordings menu is now a batch UI that you can drag and drop or use the file picker to bring files into and then specify an output location and send them all at once. Auto remuxing is a checkbox located in the advanced settings under the recording section. You can now tell OBS to resize your recording canvas in order to match a specific source's size. This is super useful if you just want to record a specific window or source and have it stay at the native resolution and aspect ratio of that source without having to manually figure that out yourself. Right-click the source in the sources list and hit resize output source size. It will have a confirmation dialog and things like that, but you know what you're doing. As I've teased a couple times now in my videos, I have a couple dedicated videos about this, you can enable multiple audio track recording for custom ffmpeg output settings. This means you can set up multiple wave uncompressed audio tracks with whatever video codec you want pretty much, and things like that. I have a full video on an earlier peek at this feature linked in the video description. The actual scene canvas UI has actually been overhauled quite a bit to better show outlines and handles for sources, show when sources are overlapping and where they interact when overlapping over each other or hovering over each other, and when they go outside the boundaries area of the canvas. This is a little polishing touch that goes a very long way to making the UI more user-friendly and even more friendly for colorblind users. Photoshop PSD files can finally be used as image sources. I've been doing this in Wirecast since like 2011. I'm glad to see it added. Support for the Linux VA API H.264 encoder has been added to OBS Studio on Linux. This is an open source GPU hardware encoder decoder, which has built-in compatibility with MISA and works natively with Intel and AMD open source GPU drivers. Kind of like the Linux open source alternative to Intel QuickSync and AMD AMF. It's pretty cool. Image slideshows now use less memory and are less prone to crashing. You can also add an audio filter to invert your audio polarity to prevent phase cancellation of dialogue getting cut out or to deliberately cut out dialogue. This is how karaoke machines sometimes remove vocals from songs. You can also now pan audio with stereo balancing and advanced audio properties. A downward expander audio filter has also been added. This is like a noise gate, but a lot smoother, as it just lowers the volume levels instead of cutting out the audio entirely and can produce a lot better results. It's like an inverse of what you'd normally use a compressor for. You can also now add a fourth aux input in device audio settings, which is good for people like me with a lot of audio devices. Blackmagic DeckLink output cards can be used as well, and even their keying support for chroma keying. I don't really have a way to test this out right now because I only have a DeckLink input card, but it's there. So while we've had a long wait for this new update, about 5 months or so, which is one of the longest amounts of time that they've gone, I think it was worth it, as there are crucial features and functionality being improved, and the groundwork for some really cool stuff coming in the future have been set up here, and I am more excited than ever. The download link for the update and changelog will be added to the description below. Once available, there will be a beta release client you can test out for yourself to provide feedback if you want that instead. I'm filming this before it fully releases, although the auto updater should have you covered when it does release. While you're down there, click the link to go follow me on Twitch at twitch.tv/ebuildsbox, hit the like button, and subscribe for more tech education. Check out my OBS masterclass if you're new to this, whole OBS live streaming thing.